played, and both of these teams in much need of a win tonight. You know, if you look at the standings, Chatham's at the bottom of the East Division. Wareham on a three-game slide. They haven't won a game in four games. But Wareham has been much better at home this year. 3-2 at home. They've hit better at home. They've pitched better at home. They've fielded better at home. The home and road splits are pretty stark in the first about 11 games of the season.
The leadoff hitter for the Anglers is Jansen Reeder. It was J.J. Weatherholt the last time these two teams played. Boy, what a difference a week can make. It's going to be Reeder, Benjay, and Schubert to lead things off. First pitch, right down the middle for strike one. Underway at 5:59. The 0-1 is grounded to second. Takes a weird hop, but right in the glove of Garen Caulfield after all those weird hops late last night. Good for the Gateman to get a early out. The pitcher is Brett Wachowski.
Yeah, different Chatham lineup. As you mentioned, Weatherholt, Antonacci, and Miller Green were 1-2 and 3 in the Chatham lineup last Friday, and we got Reeder, Benj, and Schubert tonight, the top three. The USA guys for Chatham, three of them, two pitchers, and Weatherholt leaving this morning, so a new-looking roster for the Anglers.
4-3 put out, now a strike down the middle to Carson Benj, designated hitter. Carson is out of Oklahoma State. We mentioned Tom Holliday, deep connections with the Cowboys. Up the middle, gets by the mound, and just squeaks by Caulfield up, base hit with one out for the designated hitter.
Benj is one of the few guys in this league. In fact, tomorrow for Katuit, one of them is a probable, a two-way guy, and he actually missed his first year in 2022 because of Tommy John surgery. So you already have players that are really impressive at the Cape doing either hitting or pitching, and then you've got a guy like Benj who can do both at a pretty high level.
Two Oklahoma State Cowboys in the top three of this lineup. Here's Nolan Schubert, left fielder. Digs in from his left side. Pitch outside, 1-0.
Schubert had a great game last Friday. Had a scorching double down the left field line. Was brand new to Chatham at that point and has settled in pretty nicely for the Anglers.
Good crowd tonight at Spillane. Friday night, 1-0. Popped in the air center field. Back racing is Stevenson. And it's over his head and off the wall on a fly. Going to second and holding there with a double is Schubert. Benj is at third. So the opening pitch is an out for Wachowski, but the next two batters reach base and bring up Chris Maldonado, the second baseman.
We are powered by TrackMan, and that ball was hit 104 miles an hour off the bat. That is a big league swing right there from Nolan Schubert, and he's only a freshman, but the way he swings the bat, it doesn't really look like he's going to be going into his sophomore year. It seems like a guy that some scouts are going to be looking out for to draft in a few weeks.
The hitter now is Chris Maldonado, second baseman out of Vanderbilt. And there's the first reset for Wachowski. Opening offering, swing and a miss. Scouts galore today. Came as early as 3 hours before first pitch. That's how you know you got two very talented teams playing. And with the Cape League, it happens almost every night. 0-1, Wachowski a chest-high set. Swing and a miss, 0-2.
Brett's got great stuff, mostly working off the fastball and the slider. Interested to see how he does in an extended outing because he throws two pitches a vast majority of the time in fastball slider. So how can he get through the lineup a second time if Ryan Smythe gives him the opportunity to do that?
0-2 has the sign. Runners on second and third base. Here's the pitch. Just tie, 1-2. It's the first redshirt Friday of 2023 at Spillane Field. We had it last week in Chatham. The home team wears red, the special Cape League jerseys. 1-2 popped in the air, foul right side.
And the significance behind those red jerseys is honoring our nation's military, those who have been deployed, just trying to show some appreciation for our troops.
1-2, one out. Runners on second and third. Wachowski in trouble early. Crack bat, rolls, foul. That ball went flying to short.
think the bat probably had a higher exit velocity than that ball did.
And it split very unevenly. Cowboy Brett. He was left with just the handle. And Maldonado will have to get a new bat.
Yeah, that's one of the examples of the different changes between metal bats and wood bats. With wood bats, you just can't get away with as much as you can with metal bats. Metal bats, you get jammed, you might dunk a hit. Wood bat, you get jammed, you're going to have to find a new piece of lumber.
Maldonado with Caden Kent on deck. Powerful five to start this. Stands on the back line of the box. Takes it high. Count evens at 2-2. Witrowski really could use an out here. Got the opening batter to ground out and then allowed two big hits. Neither were really weak balls. They were both really barreled up. 2-2. Pop foul again. And how about the battle for Maldonado refusing to go down in an early opportunity for the Anglers to score some runs?
Yeah, Chatham has struggled mightily to get runs across the board this year, averaging 3 runs a game.
The 2-2 popped up right side. This should stay in fair play. Underneath it is Stewart. There will be a tag. Throw is really good. It's just late, though. Sliding in safely is the designated hitter, Benji. It brings Schubert over to third base. And an F9 is the opening out, a second out.
Number 60.
Good throw by Zach Stewart from right field, but Carson Benj is just an athlete. We talked about his ability as a two-way guy, talked about his ability to play in the outfield, pitch, hit for contact, steal bases, and Stewart put a lot of mustard on it, just didn't put enough of it on it.
Benj is in. Schubert goes to third. Caden Kent, first baseman, takes outside. Kent out of Texas A&M, the Aggie. 3 Oklahoma State Cowboys in this lineup. A lot of Big 12 representation with Kansas and Texas also on the Angler roster. Fouled away 1-1. Tanner Witt will be the starter when we switch sides in the bottom of the first. He's out of Texas, and the leadoff hitter, Jansen Reeder, was from Kansas. Back of the lefty box. Kent checks his swing. It takes an inside strike 1-2.
Going to the 1-1 slider right there, and you could tell Kent was not really ready for it because it jumped in on his hands and he flinched too late for him.
Kyson Donahue waits on deck. 2 out of the inning, runner on third base. Witrowski deals outside. Nice block behind the dish by Yadi Hernandez. Defensively for the Gateman, Wallace in left, Stevenson in center, Zach Stewart is in right. So Nick McLean gets the night off. Pretty much for the first time since he got here, he gets the day off. J.C. Colon's at third. Dorian Gonzalez at short. Garen Caulfield at second. Grant Hussey's at first. Pitch is low in the count now. Full at 3-2. On the mound is Brett Witrowski. And Yadi Hernandez is behind the dish.
Yeah, I was talking with McLean before the game. He's doing all good. Just a much-needed off day for him after a lot of days of good production.
The 3-2. Chopped beyond the mound over to Caulfield at second. And he throws him out at first, so Kent is set down, and the inning comes to a conclusion. But the Gatemen give up the early run. 1 run on 2 hits, no errors, and they leave a runner on base. Half an inning is in the books. Let's hear from Amanda when we come back. We're back on the Gatemen Baseball Network with Jack Hunter, Amanda Foster coming up next inning. I'm Aiden Blank, very happy to have you with us. Lineup for the Gateman reads like this. Josh Stevenson leads off in center field. Then it's West Virginia's Landon Wallace batting second and in left. Third hitter is Zach Stewart. He's in right. David Glancy cleans up and is DHing. He did not play last night, so he's back. Dorian Gonzalez, the shortstop out of Miami, bats fifth. The second baseman, Garen Caulfield, bats sixth. He's from Arizona. West Virginia's Grant Hussey is in the 7th spot. He'll play first. Yadi Hernandez, as we mentioned, catching. He'll hit 8th. And J.C. Colon, the third baseman, will round out. Colon's been getting on base a whole heck of a lot the last couple of games, and good to see him back as Josh Stevenson leads off. And Chatham brings, much as they did, a fairly new lineup, a fairly new defensive alignment, Jack.
Yeah, Donahue, Miyoka, Maldonado, and Kent around the diamond. Schubert, Reeder, and Schallenberger from left to right in the outfield.
Leadoff hitter is Josh Stevenson out of LSU in the first pitch. Low from the starting pitcher, Tanner Witt, out of Texas. You mentioned Witt has dealt with some injuries. He had Tommy John surgery, so it's good to see him back. The 1-0. Tap to the backstop, foul, 1-1.
Witt came onto the scene very hard in 2021. Pitched 57 innings for the Longhorns, 3.16 ERA. Highly touted prospect. Had Tommy John, caused him to miss most of the 2022 and 23 seasons, but he's back now. Highly anticipated start.
1-1, outside 2-1.
And I was talking to some Chatham folks before the game, and some of them feel like this is a really big chance for Witt to tell the scouts what he's looking like now coming off of Tommy John surgery. This could be the difference between a first round and a fourth round draft pick in a few weeks.
Off the end of the bat, goes to short, and it's booted by Mayola. So should be a leadoff single for Stevenson. Give it to him. And it brings up Landon Wallace with an early runner. Stevenson had one heck of a game yesterday. You know, we've been kind of waiting for him to burst on like that, and he finally did.
Yeah,
sets the stage for Wallace and has earned himself the leadoff spot.
Looked like a changeup right there. He just went the other way with it. It's going to be an infield hit for Stevenson in the book.
First pitch to Wallace. Squares bunt, pulls it back. He changed his batting gloves. He told me we did when he first came to play. We talked about his yellow batting gloves from West Virginia. And he said, well, they weren't feeling so great, so I switched them. They're gray tonight. Ball and no strikes to the righty hitting left fielder. Check back on Stevenson, and he slides in. Always a painful slide there to first base on the gravel. 1-0. Witt going from the set for the first time tonight. Or stretch, rather. Breaking ball goes high. 2-0.
Witt goes fastball, curveball, changeup. And he's been mixing in a slider, tight slider slash cutter a little bit. That didn't really throw this past year for Texas, but on the Cape is going to try to establish it a little bit more.
2-0 offering is on the way. The pitch. Golfed in the air, right side, trailing foul territory. Kent hustles, does not have it. Goes towards, or just beyond the first base grandstands. Just as it was for us, it's a long trip for Chatham, almost all the way across the Cape. Gateman will have one heck of a travel schedule next weekend. Thursday at Harwich, Friday at Cotuit, and Sunday in Orleans. Check back to first, and again, Stevenson's ahead of Kent's tag.
How nice is it for Josh Stevenson to lead off the inning with a hit? Gateman hitters this year are hitting 167 to lead off an inning in almost 80 at-bats.
2-1, runner goes, swing and a miss. Stevenson there, and safe. Just ahead of Maldonado's tag. And he has himself a hit and a stolen base. You know, he's in the portal, making a big name for himself early on. He would be a very valuable addition to just about any team in this country, especially with the experience he had coming to the Cape now. He's played in the SEC for a couple of years. He could bring a lot to whoever gets him. Next pitch to Wallace is inside. He turns out of it. The count runs 3-2.
Well, no doubtably a lot of scouts here tonight to see Tanner Witt because, as I mentioned, he's a guy that with some good Cape starts could be a first-round pick. With some bad Cape starts could be coming back to school, could be a third or a fourth-round pick. But when you're Josh Stevenson, you're Landon Wallace, and you're Zach Stewart, when you got a lot of eyes, you know, they're maybe coming to see a pitcher like Tanner Witt. But that doesn't mean they have to look at Witt alone. So if you're Stevenson, you're putting up a good performance, eyeballs watching, you never know what that could do for you, either from a college perspective or moving on in the future MLB draft.
Payoff pitch for Landon Wallace. Offers in the air, right side, foul territory. And drops just in back of the dugout. Wallace spoils another pitch. It's been a great at-bat from Landon Wallace. How about the fight from him? Stevenson went at Witt early and was able to eke out an infield single, but Wallace has battled deep in this count. Everything Witt throws, he's spoiling, he's taking some really good pitches here.
Wallace is an impressive hitter, so when he had his first game and he struck out a few times, you know, 3 and 4 at-bats, it's a little surprising and not something that you think is probably going to continue.
3-2. Pitch on the way. And he fouls off another. Landon Wallace battling in the second at-bat of the first inning after the Gateman give up the early run.
Landon's a guy that's got so much pop to the opposite field. If you look at him swing, it's almost kind of like he's allergic to pulling the ball, which is not exactly a bad problem to have.
Another set. Pitch. High for ball 4. What an excellent at-bat from Landon Wallace. 2 runners on base now for Zach Stewart.
Now bad. Right,
good plate discipline, and you know that's what the Gatemen are going to need to do. The story the last 2 nights has really been the pitching staff, but flying under the radar, the offense has struggled a little bit too. Only 2 runs versus the Falmouth Commodores. They scored a good bit of runs early yesterday versus YD, but couldn't get a run late when they needed it.
First pitch to Stu. Breaks low and inside. You mentioned Zach got the Gateman on the Cape League, their statistical leaderboard, which is powered by Trackman, one of the hardest hit balls in the league this season.
Number 5 at 105 off the bat.
High set 1-0. Just upstairs 2-0.
So if you're a hitter right now, you see Witt has thrown 2 straight changeups above the zone. So you kind of think to yourself, well, how confident is he in that pitch? So you can kind of deduct that pitch from his arsenal knowing that he's not really established it.
3 balls and no strikes on Missouri Valley Conference's freshman of the year. It's been a little bit slow to start here in Wareham, but he's had flashes of real good stuff at the plate. And he works another walk, so in a much-anticipated start from Witt, he has been all over the place to start this game. An infield single, he loses a long battle with Wallace, and now walks 2 batters in a row here, putting Stewart on. And now facing David Glancy, he is a very tough hitter to have with the bases loaded, and no doubt that's what Tom Holliday is saying. Chatham's manager has gone out for his first mound visit.
Holliday, a longtime pitching coach, too, so you see some managers go out and 100% of the time they're pulling the pitcher. You see some managers go out and 50% of the time they're pulling the pitcher, and this is much more of that situation here where he's not coming to take him out of the game. He's coming to, you know, try to tell him to breathe a little bit, slow him down a little bit. And the thing is for Witt is fastball and curveball is go-to pitches. And really he's been trying to get that cutter / tight slider and the changeup working early, but both of those pitches he just has not been able to establish.
Holliday made the Anglers coach back on August 10, 2017 after that long reign of John Schiffner. First pitch to Glancy is high. What's the approach here with Glancy? You can't really throw him too much over the plate because the dude is bound to hit it.
But you got to challenge him because there's nowhere to put him. Yeah, trust your stuff. If you're a top draft pick, you got to have it.
1-0. Swings through it, 1-1. Well, you've got Dorian Gonzalez in the hole. He's wearing 7 tonight, not 17, as he usually does because he misplaced his jersey. The 1-1 is outside, 2-1. Summer baseball shenanigans is what we would file that under.
Dorian's been swinging a hot bat recently, so on the on-deck circle, he's got to really focus what Witt tries to do here.
Still nobody out. 2-1 pitch. Popped in the air, foul right side. In foul ground. Kent racing over. Thinks he has it. He does not. It looks like it dropped into the screen or just into the netting there. I kind of lost it.
Got out of play.
Yeah, it did get out of play. Kent and Schallenberger both thought they had plays. Neither did, so the count stays at 2-2. Just a week ago tonight, the Anglers won the first meeting of these two teams at Veterans Field. They will each have one more meeting at home, one more here and one more in Chatham. And, of course, they played in the Cape League Championship in 2018. Could very well happen again. 2-2 is low, 3-2, but still a long way to go for that. This is the second game of an East Division kick. We're back to West Division play tomorrow and Sunday. Gatuit here tomorrow and then at Hyannis on Sunday before another interdivisional matchup with Brewster on Monday. Payoff. Glancy fouls it right side, and that another one hit well. He's sticking around in this count. Keeps it full.
And Glancy's the guy you want up at the plays. Got to be well-rested after a much-needed off day yesterday after playing pretty heavily the first 10 games of the year.
Payoff pitch for Glancy. On his way. Chop left side, fouled. You mentioned Glancy got the off day yesterday. A bat that it turned out they could have used. 5-1 lead evaporated in the ninth, and they lose the game in the 10th. I think just a stunning turn of events those last two innings. After it looked like the Gateman had the Red Sox down. High fly ball. Left center field, back is Reeder, positions himself and makes the catch right where the warning track should be. Tagging are Stevenson and Wallace. Stevenson's in and the ball game is tied at one apiece as Glancy records an RBI and the first out of the inning.
That's such a great at-bat by David Glancy and a great swing too. You really gotta hit the ball to get it out to center field, and he hit it square. Loved how he worked the count, fouled off a few pitches. And I love how on time his swing is. It looks very fluid, in rhythm, and he always meets the baseball with extreme brutality. I mean, he hit that one on the screws, but like I mentioned, you really got to hit it well to get it out.
Now it's Miami's Dorian Gonzalez. Shortstop takes outside ball one.
He hit it 97 miles an hour off of the bat. I mean, when you're getting near 100, like, you can't really complain about how hard you're hitting it.
1-0 dealt. Fouled away left side. For the Anglers, we mentioned a lot of different faces. Similar deal for the Gateman, though they're not all in the lineup. Remember, Friday was the debut of a lot of these Gateman. That first big roster dump came on Thursday. This will be the first time that Caulfield, Hussey, and Landon Wallace face the Gateman. High fly ball down the left field line. Into foul ground, and it drops. I should say face the Anglers.
And the biggest thing for Glancy's at bat on the last at bat too is, yeah, sure, he hit the ball hard, worked a good count, but he did his job. You need to lift a fly ball to the outfield and not only get the runner home, which he did in Stevenson, but push Wallace to third, because now with a guy that can handle the bat well in Dorian Gonzalez, you've got a runner on third and less than two outs. And those are situations that when you got Cape bats up here, you expect them to get the run in.
Set for Witt. The Longhorn brings home a 1-2. Swing and a miss. Wow, look at the drop on that pitch. Excellent breaking ball to take out Gonzalez. Two down for Garen Caulfield.
I see so much Justin Verlander in this guy, Tanner Witt. The way he's coming up over the top on his release point, and that curveball from that high release point just plummets down, and there's a reason why that pitch is just a bat misser.
Now it's the second baseman out of Arizona. Garen Caulfield takes ball one. Grant Hussey waits on deck. Moved down in the lineup. He's been up the first couple of games, but moved down tonight into the seven spot. 1-0 en route. Inside, Caulfield claims it hit him, and it did. So the bases are loaded again. This feels like a big opportunity for the Gateman to score early. It's a 1-1 tie game, chance to take the lead right now. And who better to do that than the guy who was second on West Virginia's team in home runs this spring, and Grant Hussey, has not had the best start at the plate, but has an opportunity to really do some damage. The big swinging lefty, a West Virginia native, waits on a curveball and takes it for strike one.
Yeah, that curveball can be really effective early in counts, because if you're a hitter going up to the plate, you're not going to be sitting on that curveball first pitch.
0-1. Full wine from Witt. 0-2. The majority of the crowd, as usual, is down on that third base grandstand. Peppering of folks in the outfield and on the stands first base side. The 0-2 from Witt. In the air. Deep right field, it's back. It is deep and it's long gone. The Hus-Bus rolls to Spillane with his first home run of the season. And the Gatemen have a grand slam early to make it 5-1 Wareham.
Grant Hussey with an express ticket over the fence. How about it? The Gatemen needed a big hit and they got it here in the bottom of the first.
Well, if anybody needed a home run there, it's Grant Hussey. Not the most successful start, but as you can see, he is back in full force. The first pitch bounces off the plate to Yadi Hernandez. It's ball one. The Gatemen now have sent eight to the plate in this first inning. A very successful first. They have scored as many runs today as they did yesterday, and we're not even through an inning. 1-0 on the way. The pitch. Back up the middle, and Hernandez keeps the two-out rally going. A base hit. Well, that was about as perfectly hit as you could ask for. You know, when you're taking BP, you always want to go right up the middle. And that's exactly what Yachty just did to set the stage for J.C. Colon, third baseman out of Missouri.
I mean, Yachty, it's kind of hard to see the success that he's been having because he doesn't play every day. But, I mean, he's sneakily climbing the ranks batting average-wise. He's 6-for-13 on the year.
The first pitch, in for strike one. We should note they're back to three catchers. Last night, the activation of Tommy Spillane. We would imagine we'll see him within the next couple of games. So you'll rotate between Spillane, Hernandez, and Ryan Campos, 1-1. It's going to be very interesting when he gets his first at-bat. We can say Spillane hitting at Spillane.
It's a broadcaster.
What a difference one letter can make.
Broadcaster's worst nightmare.
The 0-1 on the way to the righty. Cologne, roller left side, picked up Mayola, throwing first base. In time, no, he beat it out. How about Cologne legging out an infield single? Mayola has had two weirdly hit balls on that left side. The first one was Stevenson's to lead off the inning, and there Cologne. He's left too much space there to the right of him, and he just hasn't been able to cover enough ground.
That ball really wasn't hit hard enough for Mayola to make a play on it. I mean, there's really not that much he could do. Cologne's a guy that can run, and Stevenson up for the second time here in the first.
Stevenson led off this inning, and he gets another at-bat, and the ball gets by Hobson, and suddenly there are runners on second and third. A base knock for Stevenson could make this a 7-1 game. And wouldn't that be a sight for sore eyes? The Gatemen, who have gotten beaten up the last couple of days. Last time they were here, lost a heartbreaker 4-3, in which they had the tying run on second base in the ninth. And then they get beat up in Falmouth, 12-2. And they lose just an awful finish yesterday in YD. They could really use a win. They could really use this big first inning. Up the middle, but right at Mayola, who saves the two runs from scoring. Stevenson put a good barrel on it, but it's an L6, and the inning comes to a conclusion. But hey, the offense is back. Five runs in the inning. They come on 1, 2, 3, 4 hits with no errors, and two runners are left on base. Inning in the books, and boy, is it good to see the Gatemen back to their winning ways, 5-1, as we go to the second. They're a little small, I'm not going to lie.
I got the
meat. Sorry, beggars can't be choosers. We're not going to complain. The first pitch is a strike as the Anglers come to the plate. Well, they sent five to the plate in the first, and we thought that was pretty good. The Gatemen put up a five spot. Up the middle from Kyson Donahue. Base hit down on Stevenson at center, so neither pitcher totally clean in their first inning. They both give up some runs. The difference is Witt gets really rocked by that Gatemen offense. He's lucky Mayola was cheating towards the bag as far as he was, because Stevenson very easily could have made it a 7-1 game at the end of that inning.
Yeah, powered by TrackMan, 105 94 miles an hour off the bat there for Tyson Donahue. That's a barrel.
Same as the earlier one, the double from Schubert. That ball hits Miola. The shortstop has reached base, so Witrowski now running into problems of his own in the second. Runners are on first and second for Mark Schallenberger,
who is the right fielder out of Evansville.
Having a big lead as a pitcher, it can be really nice. It can help you take a deep breath and take a little pressure off, but sometimes it can be bad for a pitcher because they can lose focus. They're in the dugout for a while, get a little rusty coming back out. So Witrowski's got to lock in and kind of forget about the lead he's got.
First pitch to him is high and outside. One ball and no strikes.
And you don't want to forget about it in the sense of, you know, you still got to attack and be aggressive like it is a one-run game. But you got to have the focus of that it's a one-run game.
1-0 offering. He deals a strike. It's 1-1. Biggest thing that the Gateman can do tonight is throw strikes. That's been their problem the last two games. When they've run into issues, it's been because they walk a lot of batters. Anybody who can throw strikes on this team has generally done pretty well. The pitch is outside 2-1.
Yeah, and they did a great job of it for eight innings yesterday.
Yes.
Casey Talent was
absolutely
fantastic. Lucas Malstedt was phenomenal per usual. Frontera had a good eighth inning. The ninth inning came around, it was a different story, but a great 90% of the game.
2-1. Deals an inside strike 2-2. Caden Hobson waits on deck. Maybe the non-hitter. Schallenberger, the eight-hitter. With two runners on base in the top of the second. Witrowski deals. Checked his swing. Rolled it left side. Witrowski stumbling. Nowhere to go with it. Has to eat it and give up the infield single. Well, I don't know what happened there, but he kind of got his legs crossed up coming off the mound. And what should have been at least an out turns into an infield single, puts runners on all the bases. Bases are loaded. You're in the second inning.
Well, if you like offense, you're in the right spot. And for Witrowski, that mound is, you know, higher than it looks from up here. So descending off of the mound sometimes as a pitcher, get your feet tangled. You just can't find your footing, and it was a perfectly placed infield single.
The first offering to Caden Hobson is off the end of the bat, dying in center, and a nice leaping grab by Dorian Gonzalez. Nobody advances. Saves the run there. So I guess an F6?
Yeah.
Maybe with a little star in the book there. Gonzalez sprawling out to make the catch and keeping it shallow enough that Donahue could not score. We're back to the top of the order with Jansen Reeder. How about that great catch out at shortstop? Gonzalez really coming into his own here. We mentioned he didn't play much with Miami in the spring, but boy, has he enjoyed getting reps in Wareham. The first pitch is low to Reeder.
Reeder is a guy that, from the left side, leadoff bat, can handle the bat well, so you got two runners on in scoring position, Gateman infield back. He's got one job to do, and it's get that runner in from third.
1-0. Off the end of the bat, fouled. 1-1.
And it's still early in the game, too, so, you know, they're down four, and it would be nice for him to hit a three-run shot and pull this game within one. But this early in the game, you're still just trying to get the runs you can get. So ground ball anywhere on the infield except to the pitcher, you get a run home, move the runner to third, and you got to be happy with his performance.
1-1. Gets him on the outside corner. It was 1-2 now. The home plate umpire had us all confused, Jack.
He's just practicing. Mickey Garcia behind the plate. He said, everybody, I'll take it. A rare mistake.
Well, we're always taught, go by what the umpire says. Pitch goes low and the count's 2-2. Because the umpire's the one keeping the official count. We don't, you know, you can look at the scoreboard, but what the umpire says goes there.
Hey, Mickey.
And so, you know.
He's got a good strike three call. I'll give him that. He's warmed up and ready to go.
2-2. Swing and a miss. There's the high heat. Mickey not as emphatic on the call, but it is strike three. Reeder starts his day 0-2. And now Carson Benge.
Number 7, Carson Benge.
Had himself a single last inning. Those stir-up Blue Sox scored the only run so far for the Anglers. Chatham comes in 3-6-1, six points. The Gatemen are 4-5-1. I beg your pardon, that's 4-7 points because they do get the point for the tie. Outside now 1-1. The Gatemen come in with 9 points at 4-6-1. So the only difference between these two teams is one win. Gatemen have one more than the Anglers right now, both hanging around in the East and West Division standings respectively, but would love to move up. First base side, flip to the bag, and Witrowski hangs a goose egg after loading the bases with nobody out. He retires three in a row. A very impressive finish to the inning from Brett. No runs on two hits, no errors, and three left on our way to the last of the second. Gatemen lead it 5-1 on the Gatemen Baseball Network. A very eventful start for the Gatemen on this Friday night. Very happy to have you with us. A very happy crowd here at Spillane Field with Jack Hunter, Amanda Foster. I'm Aiden Blank. It's the Gatemen 5 and the Anglers 1. Gatemen jumped all over Witt in the first, set 10 to the plate. Landon Wallace had an at-bat last inning, walk, scored a run. And now hits one back up the middle. How about another Gatemen hit? Well, all the Gatemen hitting that was really stifled over the last couple of days, you know, came back a little yesterday, but it's really come out in the first two innings today. That's kind of what happens in summer ball. You can get, you know, practically no hit one day and come back the next and hit really well.
And that's baseball. You've got to be able to mentally flush it, you know, during batting practice today. The vibes, the team morale really wasn't that low. Ball gets away.
Runner goes, and they miss the pickoff. Wallace is flying around second. He's going to third. Throw coming in is not in time. Wallace gets both bases and a runner on third with nobody out.
Yeah, just not a great throw there from Witt on the pick. And Ken at first base could not handle it. And it, back to what I was saying, the morale of batting practice really wasn't that bad because you can't, in baseball, you cannot hang on a game. You know, you cannot let one game define your season, define your week. So these guys after the game just flush it down the toilet, come back today, ready to win.
It's going to go down as an E1, strike into Stewart. Walked in his last at bat. So the error is charged to Witt, who is kind of just, well, not he's having one of those nights where you just can't, either can't find the strike zone, and when you do, they barrel it up, like Hussey did, and like Wallace just did. Got to find a way to bear down. 1-1, cut and a miss, 1-2.
It's a great changeup, and you see why people like him. He's got great stuff. The curveball and the changeup, when it's in the right spot, is a really nice pitch.
Ball and two strikes. Lefty back in the box. Pitch. Outside and low, 1-2-2.
And see, the problem is when you can't establish your curveball and you can't establish your changeup, it makes your fastball less effective because the hitters are expecting the fastball more.
We hope for this to be the first of a number of redshirt Fridays here. They just charged a pitch clock violation.
I believe so. I thought he was saying balk at first, but maybe not the K.
3-2 offering now. Fouled away. Well, you couldn't tell whether he was saying balk or ball.
He's saying something real loud. He must have given him a ball.
And again, we don't have the pitch clock timer here. I believe Chatham does, right?
Do.
Yeah, Chatham did. Not every field does. I would guess within the next couple of years, that becomes a mainstay of each field. Pitch on the way is low. And Stewart draws two walks. How about some patient at-bats from Stewart? Down with two strikes and is able to get himself back on base. Brings up David Glancy. Had a flyout last inning. Now comes up with runners on the corners. Had bases loaded last time he came up, so two big opportunities for Glancy. Bases loaded, now two on. The righty hitter stands in. And Witt deals upstairs. Witt's had some command control this inning. He's now walked a batter. He's walked a grand total of three over these last two innings. 1-0. Left side, shoots through the hole. It's a base hit for David Glancy. An RBI single for him. Two RBI on the night. He had the sack fly last at bat. Wallace is in. And the Gatemen make it a 6-1 ball game. Well, how about this? This is exactly the kind of night they needed. And Tom Holliday is coming out. He's going to make a pitching change, it appears. This is the exact kind of night the Gatemen needed. They were down. They lost a heartbreaker yesterday. And they've come out just shooting every single batter, is finding a way on base, whether that be via a hit or a walk. They're having really good at-bats. Ryan Smyth has to be smiling from ear to ear right now.
Yeah, you know, the thing with Witt is you feel really bad for him, first of all, because you never want to see a guy come back from an injury like that. Seems like a great guy. And, you know, with scouts here, you never want to see him blow up like this. But the thing is for him is his fastball hanging 88, 89 on the gun, and you leave it right over the plate, you can't establish your breaking stuff, you're going to get hit hard in this league. And the Gatemen have done a really nice job at just barreling baseballs today. They've come out a little angry, and you can probably guess why. Now, Chatham's going to have to go to the bullpen here with zero outs in the second inning, and that's not going to be what Tom Holliday wants.
Well, I think that just about any manager or coach in this Cape League will tell you, you know, best teams, even the best teams in this league, are going to finish right around 500. So that means that, you know, having two games like Wareham just did means very little in the grand scheme of things. There's 44 this season. They're already, you know, 8 points, 9 points up in the standings. Having those games doesn't mean much. What means much is the fact that they're able to bounce back with a night like this, that they're able to go, you know, 0 for 3 their last three nights and still come back and hit the ball and play well, because that shows they have a little tenacity. And that eventually, yeah, the bats are going to get cooking. Chatham's gone to the bullpen.
Can I have your attention, please? Now pitching for the Anglers, out of Gonzaga, number one, Liam Paddock.
It's going to be Liam Paddock out of Gonzaga. So from the Pacific Northwest to the Great Northeast, he comes in a very tricky situation here, because there's two runners on base already. Both are going to get charged to Witt if they score. But at this point, there is very little that he's going to be able to do to help them win this game other than just get people out. A lot of the work is going to have to come from the Angler offense.
Yeah, he throws a fastball, throws a curveball in the mid-70s, a two-year JUCO guy. He's got to get outs, but this is a tough situation for him, as you alluded to, because you got runners on base. You know, one swing is not a solo home run. One big swing is a three-run home run, and you got less room to operate here. So Mike Mobbs down at third base is giving Dorian Gonzalez the scouting report. We're ready to go.
Dorian Gonzalez.
Well, yesterday we learned about mobism, about, you know, if you want the cookie, you got to go get the vegetables. Everything feels like a cookie tonight to this Gatemen offense. Even the veggies are still tasting real good. And let's see what can be cooked up by Dorian, who struck out last inning. The first pitch to him. In for a strike, it's 0-1.
I was talking with Mike before the game, and he said he's giving out a mobism T-shirt to the player of the game, but the first rule is you got to win. So Josh Stevenson was in line for it yesterday and was a little disappointed that he couldn't come through with the free tee.
The 0-1. He fouled it off. Gonzalez got hit, but swung anyways.
I think he got in off the got jammed. I'm not sure if it really hit him in the hand.
I think it went off the front of the back of the bat, the nub.
Reaction would have been a little bit more painful.
Yeah. Miami shortstop gets ready, and the pitch bounces in the dirt, blocked by Hobson behind the plate.
Versatility is a part of summer ball. Dorian's a mostly second baseman. Played third base yesterday, getting the short start at shortstop. Have a newer position to him this season. And Cologne is another guy that's been moving around the infield a little bit.
Yeah, Dorian and J.C. Cologne can play basically anywhere on the infield. As can Bobby Bozer. Very versatile infield group for the Gateman. The 1-2. Popped in the air. Left side into the outfield. Backtracking is Miola. Ducks and gives way to the left fielder Schubert, who makes the play for the first out of the inning. Mercifully comes for the Anglers.
From Arizona,
exactly
20,
what you
Jared
needed.
Caulfield.
If you're Tom Holliday, you bring in Paddock with two runners on base, down 6-1. You need an out, and he just got it. They put down Gonzalez twice in a row. Here's Garen Caulfield, scored on that hussy home run after being hit by a pitch. Righty hitter from Arizona. Couple of looks back to second. One final look, and it's fouled away 0-1.
Paddock's got starting experience, started 5 games this past year at Spokane Community College, and then started 5 games also in the West Coast League as well. So he's got the experience needed to get through 3 or 4 innings. And we've seen teams be really effective in long relief situations against Wareham.
0-1 the count. Pitch. Pop to the backstop, 0-2. Caulfield, mainly a second baseman, but you could probably sneak him in at short if needed. But again, that's the beauty of this Gateman infield. They're all versatile. They can all play multiple positions. That's a very big help to get guys off days. Same thing with the outfield. When you can put a guy like Nick McLean in left field in his first game there, that ball gets by Hupson, and both runners advance. Stewart and Glancy now second and third.
Hey, battle up here, right? Battle up.
But as I was saying, you know, the outfielders, the fact that they don't just have to play, you know, yeah, Stevenson's mainly a center fielder, McLean's mainly in right, but they can play just about anywhere. The fact that you can move those guys around and get somebody an off day, very helpful, and especially helpful as the season moves along and, you know, guys start to get a little fatigued.
And Nick McLean was a center fielder before he came to Arizona State, too. So
exactly.
You know, that's an example of him learning a new position this past year.
Ball and two strikes, both runners on. Inside 2-2. McLean made his Gateman debut against the Anglers a week ago, and he was in left field. Two at-bats into the game. He had a home run. Certainly a Gateman debut to remember. The 2-2. Outside 3-2. Caulfield was in the lineup yesterday as a Gateman 1-for-4, batting 250. Temperature starting to seep down. Swing and a miss from Caulfield, and that's out number two. So a very strong start out of the bullpen for Paddock. You mentioned he's a starter, meaning if needed, he could probably eat up a couple more innings than maybe anybody else in that bullpen. Grant Hussey now comes up, and the Huss bus rolled into Spillane. His first at bat here couldn't have gone much better. Put it well over the right field fence. Would love to do that again here. Time has been called.
Well, the thing about Paddock is he's been a starter. He's not exclusively a starter. So he's got the experience coming out of the bullpen, and he's stretched out enough to be starter.
Fouled away. It's 0-1.
So it's a good blend, good guy that you want in a long relief situation because not exclusively a starter. So he's not on that starter routine, and he's a guy that is stretched out enough to pitch starter innings if you need him to, which you need him to in this case. But Chatham had a day off yesterday, so bullpen's going to be fresh.
0-2. Feels like it's going to be a night where everybody gets a lot of at-bats. No matter what team you're on, both pitchers have faced a decent amount of hitters already. It's going to be a lot of reps for a lot of guys. 0-2, runners on second and third. Hussey takes strike three high. Oh, he can't believe it.
Come on.
The Gateman dugout has words, too, and the last three batters of this second inning are set down. Gateman do get a run on two hits, no errors, and two runners left on base, second in the books, and Wareham in full control, up 6-1 on the Gateman Baseball Network. Back at Spillane Field, we go to the third inning, and boy, does Chatham need some bats here. They've not had the most unsuccessful day at the plate, if that makes any sense. They have not been, you know, completely shut out, but Witrowski has gotten the job done. Loaded the bases last inning and retired all three batters to close things out. Nolan Schubert leads things off, second at bat of the day after doubling in his first at bat, ball one. He really barreled that ball up. Two balls tonight have gone 104 miles an hour off the bat, and Schubert's was the first of them. Brought in the only run so far for the Anglers in Bench, and he hits a hard ball over the middle school there to the left. Foul 1-1.
You can see in the numbers across the Cape Cod Baseball League, power is really hard to come by when you got the pitchers on the mound and you got the wood bats, and Schubert's a guy we saw in his first at-bat could still hit the ball.
Powerful swing again, wide of the line at third, foul 1-2. Those last two swings, he's demonstrated that power. 92 there.
Ryan Smith's probably wondering why Schubert saves his best performances against the game. two out of his three doubles on the season now are against Wareham.
1-2. Swing and a miss. Well, how about Witrowski? He gets rocked up a little on those two foul balls, but doesn't mind it. Swing and a miss there. Pitch only came in at 83 miles an hour, but he got the job done. And sets down Schubert to bring up Chris Maldonado.
Well, that was intentional. It was a slider, and when you get those fastballs up and away, he tunneled the slider off of it, so it started up and away like it was coming like a fastball when it's well-timed to it, and then it broke down.
Wave and a miss from Maldonado, that one at 91. Good Friday night crowd. We hope to see a lot of that this summer. 0-1 offering. You know, early on in the year, it's always kind of hit or miss because you got kids still in school. You know, things haven't quite made it to summer mode yet, but by this point, we're almost to July. Popped in the air, center field, into the Bermuda Triangle, and it finds the left side of that triangle, Dorian Gonzalez. F6 for out number two, and Witrowski has retired the first two batters of the inning for the first time tonight.
Brett Slider's really working. Like we mentioned, powered by TrackMan, one of the metrics they keep track of is horizontal break, and that one was 15 inches of horizontal movement.
The hitter now is Caden Kent, first baseman, pops it off, 0-1.
To clarify, you know, there's some, like StatCast does it differently. This one takes it off of, if you threw a ball that was straight, and then you take that pitch, which was curving away, what's the difference between the two? And so 18 inches between a straight pitch and a ball that curves down like that.
Kent checks his swing. That's a strike, 0-2. Sophomore out of Texas A&M in 2023, this spring, played 28 games with 94 plate appearances. 23 runs batted in. Chopped, foul left side. His father, Jeff, played 19 years in Major League Baseball, played for the Giants, the Astros, the Dodgers, the Mets, and the Blue Jays, was a five-time All-Star and the National League MVP in 2000. Jeff Kent, one of the more recognizable names in Major League Baseball. And not the only father. D'Angelo Ortiz was here, as was Craig Counsell's son. 2-2. And that's always cool to see some of these big names like Leiter and Ortiz and Counsell and Kent playing on these small, beautiful little high school fields. Swing and a miss. How about Witrowski going 1-2-3 for the first time here in the third. 2.5 in the books, and the Gatemen are rolling. They lead this thing 6-1. Back for the bottom of the third on the Gatemen Baseball Network. Back in Wareham on a nice, crisp summer night. And the Gatemen, boy, have they come out gangbusters. 6-1 the score. 8-9-1, starting with Yadi Hernandez. looping curveball misses upstairs.
The catcher from Seton Hall.
Another inning of work.
Yanni Hernandez.
For Chatham's Liam Paddock. For two-thirds, all, actually, beg your pardon, got all three outs that last inning. Strike one, it's 1-1. Jump on it. He came in and really slammed the door there. Struck out the last two batters. 1-1. 2-1. And he's done his job so far, which is calm things down. Stop the bleeding with these Gateman bats. Hernandez, the eight hitter, singled in his first appearance in the first, and is now in a hitter's count at 3-1. We're back tomorrow, another home game. 6 p.m. start against the Cattleers of Kituit. The Gateman played early on in the season on the road and lost a very close, well-pitched game to the 3-1. Right side, but trailing foul. So some unfinished business tomorrow with Kituit, although Kituit is up 11-1 in their game against Falmouth. So after giving up that lead late, allowing all those unanswered runs, they're also letting off some steam. 3-2 is outside. Yachty is on base for the second time tonight. This time, a walk. Brings up J.C. Cologne. With a runner on and nobody out.
Something the Gateman have done a great job at today is not only get runners on to lead off innings. It gave you the number about them hitting 167 to lead off an inning this so far this year. But they've made productive outs when they've made them. They've moved runners over, sack flies, wild pitches and errors have aided that as well. But they're not just sticking guys on bases.
First pitch bunts it. It dies on the first base grass, gets to first, and no one's covering. Bunt single for J.C. Cologne. It pulled Kent off the bag. Maldonado was slow to cover, so both runners reached to lead off this inning. All three runners, all three leadoff hitters in this game have reached. And we're back to the top of the lineup with Josh Stevenson.
Great bunt, and oftentimes when you've got guys coming together from different teams, you got guys coming in late, it's really hard to establish bunt coverages and really know what to do, especially when it's not a clear sacrifice situation. So they were caught off guard. Kenton Paddock converged. The second baseman, Maldonado, wasn't covering the bag. No, nothing to do there for Chatham.
High leg kick. Looping breaking ball in 0-1. Stevenson has had two at-bats. Single in the first, scored the first Gateman run. And also in the first, lined out. Both times he's put bat on ball really well. 0-1. Bites on another breaker. It's 0-2.
Big velocity difference in his fastball and his curveball. He's sitting in the low 90s for his fastball, and that curveball came out 73 miles an hour. So if you're not prepared for it, you can definitely get out on your front side and be a little too early on it.
0-2 the pitch. He deals. Swing and a miss. Stevenson sat down for the second time today. First time via the strikeout. Brings up Landon Wallace.
It's a great pitch by Paddock because he went to the curveball to pitch before it dropped in the strike zone. So Stevenson's thinking to himself, well, if he gives me another curveball in the strike zone, I've got to be able to hit it. And that one plummeted out of the strike zone for strike three.
Wallace the batter, righty, has reached base twice, takes an outer third strike. Around the league, Kituit 12, Falmouth 1. YD 2, Brewster nothing. Bourne 5, Hyannis 2. They're just underway, no score between Orleans and Harwich. All five games going on right now inside 1-1. So the Cattleers, who come in tomorrow, have been playing incredibly good baseball so far. Should have had the win last night, but gave up all those runs late and now have just demolished a very good Falmouth team 12-1. The 1-1. Inside, gets by Hobson, and once again, runners go to second and third. Only one out, so all Wallace has to do is get it out of the infield, and they can try and score that run.
Great take by Landon Wallace because he took it because he saw the spin out of the hand, because out of the release, that's a good breaking ball. It starts off as a strike, and then it goes out of the zone. So Wallace, good discipline, being able to see it early, recognize that that pitch is not going to stay in the strike zone, despite the fact that Paddock released it. in the strike zone.
2-1 pitch. Runners are on second and third base. High leg kick. Swing and a miss. Overpowers him. Though it only came in at 89. Felt like maybe that ball was rising.
A lot of induced vertical break on it. Gets that effect on it. Gets a lot of carry, ride on it. Can't really actually rise the ball.
Right,
you defy
right.
gravity. But it does give that visual effect.
The 2-2. Bounced foul. It kind of has the effect of the rise ball in softball, which actually does go up.
Well, and you got the curveball that breaks down, too, and you get the fastball
right.
that gets a little lift up in the zone. It can kind of jump on you a little bit, so it's not coming in at 97, but especially if you're seeing 73 for a few straight pitches, it really comes at you.
The 2-2 swings and misses. That one at 90, and Wallace, the second strikeout victim. How about four strikeouts for Paddock out of the bullpen?
That's pitching backwards and doing a good job of it there from Paddock. Count him early with the curveballs in the zone and kind of tunneling that fastball. So similar release to the curveball. He thinks the curveball is maybe coming. The fastball keeps jumping on him, and he takes a late protective swing for strike three.
Here's Zach Stewart. Two walks for him and does have a run scored. Runners are on second and third. And the first pitch. Right side into the glove of Kent on the ground. And he runs it over to first to conclude the Gateman half of the third. Someone's finally found an answer for the Gateman bats, and that is Liam Paddock. No runs, one hit, no errors. And they leave two runners on second and third base. We go to the fourth inning, and Wareham is in full control. 6-1 the score on the Gateman Baseball Network. It's the fourth inning here at Spillane Field in Wareham. The Gateman on top by a score of 6-1 on Wareham Community Television, D1Baseball.com, and the Gateman Baseball Network worldwide. I'm Aiden Blank with Jack Hunter. A very pleasant start to this game if you're a Wareham fan. If you're a Chatham fan, you'd like the bats to come alive here as they did in the first. First pitch is a strike as Wachowski begins inning number four of work facing Kyson Donahue. The 0-1, just low 1-1. We mentioned Wachowski's seen work out of the bullpen, but this is his first start, and a lot of folks clearly interested in what he's got to offer. The last two innings, he's only improved. The 1-1 is low 2-1. He's now set down six batters in a row. Retired the last three of the second, all with the bases loaded. And set the heart of the order down 1-2-3 in the third. He's now facing 6-7-8. Broken ball off the bat of Donahue. And it kind of bites up on Gonzalez. That's got to be an infield single to start the fourth inning. Just a weird play. You can't really do much about it.
Shattered bat, and that ball had some tricky spin on it. It was curving away from the glove of Dorian Gonzalez, who was trying to go to the first base bag to make a good throw, but not really much you could do there. Just kind of a bad luck hit.
Brings up Aiden Miola out of Oklahoma State. The shortstop was hit by a pitch and takes ball one high. It's 1-0. Wachowski deals a strike 1-1.
It's called a front door slider right there. That thing at release point looks like it's coming right at Miola, and then it gets in the door right in the strike zone.
Ball and a strike. Runner on, nobody out. And barely misses Miola, and it gets away from Hernandez. There's a weird sound from home plate. He thought maybe it was ball four, a hit by pitch. But no. He stays in the box. The righty hitter facing Wachowski, 2-1. Line drive, dunks down in left center. And the opening two base runners are aboard for the Anglers. They got something cooking here in the fourth.
Got a breaking ball up in the zone and didn't miss it. And the ball had some topspin on it, so it was sinking, which was good in this case because Wallace coming in, if that ball had some backspin on it, may have got into his glove. That ball was sinking down, a really hard hit single for Miola. And Chatham has just not gone away here offensively. And we've learned time and time again, the game is not over until the last out is made.
Right. The batter is Mark Schallenberger, takes ball one.
Especially early in the game, but you got to keep your foot on the gas. No lead for the Gateman is too small.
One ball, no strikes. First and second, nobody out. Tough spot for Witrowski. Ground ball through the right side. It gets through the 3-4 hole. Everybody holds. They don't want to test Stewart, who had a good throw earlier. And now the Anglers have loaded the bases for the second time in this game. They go to the 9-hitter, Caden Hobson, the catcher. And time has been called. No pitching change, though.
Brian Greisman going out to greet him, and pitching coach Greisman is not going to be a guy that's going to lift the ball and take it from Witrowski. And I don't think this is a situation where you take the ball from Brady. You got a bad luck single and two pretty solid singles. He hasn't shown really command issues so far in the inning from a walk perspective, but you got to have a tight leash on him now because you're facing Cape League hitters that have home run power. The leadoff hitter, Jansen Reeder's on deck, so one swing could really change everything. So you got to be ready.
Hobson is the catcher. Base is loaded. Lifts it to right. Stewart makes a sliding catch. There will be a throw home, but it's late. Well, Stu does not let the ball get in front of him. That's twice now he's come up just short on a throw home. He has the power.
Now batting.
F9 brings in Donahue from third. Everybody else stays put, though. Miola and Schallenberger both still on base. Here's Jansen Reeder, 0 for 2. Would love to correct that here and make it maybe 6 to 3. Grounds one on a hop to Caulfield. Flips to Gonzalez, one. On to first. It's a double play. Oh, that was tailor-made. 4 to 6 to 3, and the fourth comes to an end. The last of the fourth is next. Chatham gets a run back. It's 6-2 on the Gateman Baseball Network. Bottom of the fourth from Spillane Field with Jack Hunter. I made him blank. Always great to have you with us. And good to be back home after that ugly road stand for the Gateman. And clearly the Gateman are happy to be back home. You mentioned the splits between home and road, especially batting-wise. They have hit much better at Spillane Field than any other field on the Cape. David Glancy takes outside.
Well, I mean, they did score 11 runs on opening day versus Falmouth.
That's
but
true.
But then you offset that with the fact they scored two the other day. So you meet in the middle, and it's a pretty good day at the park. But
the 1-0 in for a strike, 1-1. They still lead the league in home runs. That is, what, 9 total this season?
Yep.
That is the one category there, head and shoulders above the rest of the league in. Glancy fouls it off himself. Just committed to Notre Dame, out of graduating from St. John's. So congratulations are in order for him. Great season he had at Notre Dame. Expect big things from him in the ACC. Breaking ball inside, bit into him. He goes now 2-2. Two and two to the leadoff man. Glancy fights it off again.
It's kind of funny to see how these guys are kind of nerd over the wood bats. Both Glancy and Dorian Gonzalez are swinging these red Victus bats that they pulled out of the box, and Glancy was kind of talking pregame about how the thing's got some juice in it.
Two and two the count. Oh, he ropes one to left field, but it's going to be playable for Schubert. He put a good charge into it. You could tell that ball had some pop. But that's out number one. He's now flown out twice.
now batting, the shortstop
brings
from
up
Miami,
Dorian Gonzalez.
Seven, Dorian Gonzalez.
Maybe the only hitter in this lineup that has not had a totally successful night already. 0 for 2. Everybody else has been on base at least once. So they're going to try to get Dorian on. And the pitch. Breaking ball looked like it escaped from him, and it's 1-0. One oh lefty hitter. Quiet crowd. Makes contact. And rolls it foul to the backstop, 1-1.
Dorian's not a guy that hit for a ton of power, but showed a big stick yesterday in YD with a nice backside double.
Oh, 1-1 rather. Again, he's right on it. 1-2. A pair of really good breaking balls that he is just barely making contact with. Now looking to straighten one out and make it 9 Gateman on base tonight. Every single starter, if he can reach, will have reached. The 1-2. Upstairs, 2-2. The Gateman have been real patient tonight with both Witt and now Paddock. They're not eager to get these hits. They're just waiting for them. The 2-2. Checked his swing. Did he go? He did not. The count goes full. Paddock has not had a ton of control issues, but in this at-bat, some pitches have gotten away from him. It'll be a 3-2 offering, and he fights it off again. This one goes foul down the left field line, which we don't really see. We lose it.
Well, and Paddock's fastball is playing like I think Witt wanted it to play, because Paddock's curveball has been really effective. So you get your curveball effective, and then you can really elevate your fastball and get a lot of late swings on it. Witt was never really able to establish his curveball consistently, so the high fastball didn't really play how he wanted it to.
3-2, and Gonzalez makes it 9 Gateman tonight who have reached base. Is that the first time this season it's happened?
No batting. The second base.
Is that all 9?
Arizona,
yeah.
Number 20. Aaron
or at least
Paul
all 9
Field.
Starters. Maybe in that 12-1 game against Harwich is where I would think it happened.
Definitely the fastest to get there. We're only in the bottom of the fourth.
Yeah.
But.
Jack's going to go through his archives as Garen Caulfield stands in. You know, and that's always good to see. Kind of feels like every single night there's been someone who's having you know, a really good night and maybe one or two guys who have not had the best night. But tonight's the first night where we can really say all 9 hitters have done a lot to contribute. Ball high, 1-0, and it's still the fourth inning. We are not even halfway through this thing, and the Gatemen are really rolling. It's good to see them back. This is the kind of team that gives you hope and says, yeah, they could make a deep run in the postseason. The 1-0. Batter is Caulfield from Arizona. Scored in the first by pitch. Gonzalez off first base. It'll be a 2-0. Center field. A few steps back for Reeder. 2 down. And here comes the Hus Bus. Home run, a strikeout.
Batting,
you mentioned
first baseman
that's
from
his
West
style
Virginia,
of hitting.
Number 27,
home run, walk,
Grant
strikeout.
Aussie.
And we've seen 2 of the 3 right now. Just a jack back in the first inning. Blew this thing to 6-2, to 5-1 at that point. Responsible for 4 of the runs. They try to pick Gonzalez off, and he is going to get to second base. Well, they had the right idea, but Gonzalez just took off on first move there and give him the stolen base. How about that?
There we go. All right, versus Bourne. on the 18th. All nine spots in the order reached base, although Josh Stevenson was pulled in the seventh inning. Glancy gets the hit, so not all nine starters.
The pitch, low and outside, 1-0. And I don't know if that entirely counts, or at least it deserves an asterisk, because that was an extra inning game. If you're talking about nine innings.
A lot of those base runners did reach in the 10th.
If you're talking about nine innings versus 10, it's a very different statistic there. The 1-0 popped foul. So at least for this purpose, we will say this is the first time this season in which the Gatemen have reached all nine of their starters within nine innings. The second time they've reached all nine of their starters total. Actually, Stevenson was a starter in that game, so that doesn't count. Still, the first time they've reached all nine starters. 1-1. They got Gonzalez in scoring position. See if Hussey can bring him in. Yes, he can. Base hit to center field. They're going to wave Gonzalez. Throw coming in is up the line. Dorian scores the seventh run of the night. And the lead is back to five runs for Wareham.
Isn't it good to see Grant Hussey square up some baseballs?
Yeah.
I mean, he's had a severe case of swing and miss through his first few games. And that's probably expected. I mean, these K pitchers, there's a reason this is known as a pitcher's league. And you hadn't played in a little bit. You have a little rest. You know, you might hit off the tee, hit in the caves a little bit, but there's really nothing that can simulate what he's going to face on the mound. So trying to find his footing, and hopefully he's found his footing here today.
Here's Yadi Hernandez. He's going to barrel one up right center field and caught on the run by Schallenberger. But the right idea nonetheless. From the catcher, it's an F9 to conclude the inning. Gateman do get a run. They get it on one hit, no errors, and a runner left on base. Fifth is coming up. It's Wareham 7 and Chatham 2 on the Gateman Baseball Network. It's the top of the fifth. That's Spillane Field in Wareham. 7-2, the Gateman lead. Witrowski climbs the bump, and if he can finish this inning, would be in line for the win. Deals outside 1-0, facing Carson Benge, Nolan Schubert, Chris Maldonado. The 1-0 is dealt a strike 1-1. Benge singled and scored one of the two Chatham runs in the first, and then grounded out in the second. The 1-1, right down Broadway, 1-2.
The thing that I love about Witrowski's fastball is it doesn't have the same shape every time. He's really been putting some good run on it here. But before, he's cutting the ball a little bit early on.
Chopped, second, Caulfield. We're at number one. After those two errors that really killed him late in the game last night, Caulfield's been scooping balls up, as has Hussey. The right side of the infield has really tightened up tonight, and that's good to see.
Yeah, it's good to see them be able to mentally reset. Caulfield had a fantastic snag on a ball that was hit really hard to him to end the top of the fourth on Jansen Reeder ground ball.
Brings up Schubert, double in the first, strikeout in the third. Checked his swing. He went around. It's 0-1. Witrowski so far 4 1/3 innings, 7 hits given up. That's kind of been the theme of Gateman pitching this year. They're going to give up some base runners, but they will buckle down. The good ones have been able to buckle down and get the outs. He's given up 2 runs. They're both earned runs and struck out 3 in 20 batters faced. So, again, not blowing it by anybody, but has worked a nice little rhythm. The 0-2 inside 1-2. Schubert is 5-for-21 with a pair of RBIs this season. Witrowski is throwing his second game of the season tonight. Third game, beg your pardon. The 1-2. He threw 2/3 of an inning against Bourne. Gave up 1 hit in 2 batters faced. And his big outing was 3 innings in the 3-2 loss to Kituit. Gave up a singular earned run. Has himself a 4th strikeout here and is now set down 4 in a row.
Brett has been pretty dynamic this afternoon. I mean, the changeup's been there, the slider's been there, the fastball's been there. You know, he's been hit around a little bit, but he's been able to really hunker down when he's needed to.
In that outing against Katuit, walked one, struck out two. Count is 0-1 to Chris Maldonado. He got the loss there, but it's not much of a loss. You know, 3-2 game, really well pitched. And Katuit just happened to score one more run. 1-1. Should be a fun meeting for them tomorrow. Again, 6 p.m. right here. You get the sense those two could develop a real fun rivalry. Katuit's kind of become the front runners in the West Division. Left side, Gonzalez throws him out. And the second 1-2-3 inning of the night. If that's it for Witrowski, what a great night he had. He is more than in line for the win. Bottom of the fifth coming up next. We will get it over to Jack as the Gateman roll along with a 7-2 lead on the Gateman Baseball Network. Back at Spillane Field, it's a 7-2 Gateman lead. And for the second time tonight, Tom Holliday goes to the bullpen. This time, it's Penn State's Tommy Molsky. Tommy appeared in 15 games with the Nittany Lions, making 6 starts, so he's got experience out of the bullpen as well. 3 wins, 36 strikeouts in 42 2/3 innings. 6 outings in conference, 1 start, and in 5 appearances, did not allow an earned run. We are just about set to go in the back half of this game, and to take you through it, here's Jack.
Thank you, Aiden. Tommy Molsky pitched in 5 games for the Anglers last year, went 1-0 with a 5.4 ERA. But his one outing here in 2023 wasn't very pretty. Took the loss in the game, 1 inning, 6 hits, 7 earned runs, 3 walks across the scoreboard, 2 doubles allowed, 12 batters faced. He's going to try to rebound in his second outing of the season, and to meet him, here's J.C. Colon. Colon sees it for strike one. Colon in the 9 hole today. Sees another one now down in the count. 0 balls and 2 strikes.
And don't be fooled by J.C. being in the 9 spot. He's been one of the most consistent hitters, or at least in terms of getting on base since he got here.
Josh gets a piece of it. Colon today in batting practice working on seeing the ball deep, really working on hitting the ball the other way in batting practice. He was saying that he'd rather be late, be able to still extend and be late on it, try to push something the other way than be early and pop something up or hit a slow ground ball to the pole side. 0-2, chopped. Over the mound, Maldonado up with it. And one batter faced, one out for Molsky here in the bottom of the fifth.
Well, the Angler bullpen has been pretty solid tonight.
Now batting.
They took out Wynn.
From LSU,
since then, only allowed one run.
Final line on Liam Paddock. 3 innings pitched, 2 hits, 1 run allowed, 2 walks, and 3 strikeouts. That's after the starter, Tanner Witt, went 1-plus innings and gave up 6 earned runs on 6 hits. To the top, here's Stevenson, and he sees one for strike one. Stevenson, the hero yesterday, 4-for-4 with 2 doubles and 3 RBIs. It was his first RBI and his first double as a Gateman, and decided one wasn't enough in either category.
2 doubles, really good day for him, and that park is very conducive to that because you know, they have the short fences, but they're very tall. So you can really put a charge in a ball and still not hit it out.
1-1. Slider misses inside.
You know, if the fences were to be a little bit shorter, maybe he gets a home run out of one of those pitches. But he really had a great hitting day and a great start today, too.
Pitch. Served to center. Ranging back is Jansen Reeder under it for the second out. Reeder DH'd in the Chatham and Wareham game last Friday. Schallenberger was the one to play center. Schallenberger in right tonight. Here's Landon Wallace.
may be a tough one here. Here we go, Landon.
Doesn't Wallace look a little more comfortable tonight?
The first pitch to him. Blooped. Left center field. Coming in is Schubert, and he'll get under his glove. Wallace places it perfectly. It's a two-out single. Off the end of the bat. And just hit it shallow enough.
The right fielder from Missouri State, number 53, Zach Stewart.
Nolski working with a fastball, a tight slider, and a changeup. An in-state guy for the Penn State Nittany Lions, a Pennsylvania native. Mentioned his blow-up outing last Thursday at Cotuit. Seven earned runs allowed in just one inning. Throwback. He expectedly took the loss in the game. 36 pitches, just 16 of them for strikes. The righty set from the belt, ready to go. Runner goes, popped up high, third base side. Donahue over. The ball spins back towards fair territory, but he makes the grab on the other side of the bag, and that will do it for the Gateman here in the bottom of the fifth. One hit, one left, no runs across, and no errors for the Anglers. We go to the sixth. Your score is still 7-2.
Joanne Stevenson.
For the first time in a Wareham Gateman uniform, here's Bryson Schaefer. The Coastal Carolina Chanticleer will be making his first outing here today at Spillane Field on a beautiful Friday evening. Sun about to start setting, still about 30 minutes away from that. Caden Kent, Kyson Donahue, and Aiden Miola, two lefties and a righty, scheduled to meet Schaefer. And the first pitch from the lefty is down for ball one. Schaefer's got an unorthodox delivery to the plate. Short arm swing, hides the ball well, kind of across his body too. Fouled back. Fastball, slider, curveball, cutter, and changeup. He's flashed all of them throughout this past year. And he flashes a strike. Kent is 0 for 2 on the day. He's got 8 hits on the season and game number 10. The 1-2. Off the end of the bat, a leaping grab by Gonzalez at short.
Well, that's two tonight that Gonzalez has really gone acrobatic with. It's been fun to watch him play the position. What are you scoring then? Another L6?
Yep. Kyson Donahue is going to be lifted.
Yep, and that's going to be Xavier Casarilla.
Casarilla, the infielder, committed to Oklahoma State, and we talked about the number of guys who play on this team from Stillwater. Casarilla will be headed to play for Tom Holliday's son. Waste no time, first pitch, high fly ball right center field. Stewart got turned around in all sorts of ways, but he's under it now for out number two.
So there are obviously roster limits as to how many guys from each school you can take. Do we know if he counts towards the limit on Oklahoma State players?
No, he hasn't, because he's not played a game for him. So.
Well, that's a fun way for Tom Holliday to work around that rule. But he did not play in the spring either, so this is valuable experience for him before he goes to the big leagues, per se, with Oklahoma State.
Well, he played 64 games at JUCO, Seminole State, but that. In steps Aiden Miola, but it is going to be a jump to the Division I level for sure. 1-0, skips up inside. Miola, just finishing his sophomore year for the Cowboys, went 0-3 in their last game, which was 2 days ago. Takes a hearty swing and a miss. Miola
since arriving in the last week, has struggled at the plate, but he's reached base twice already, looking for a third time. Pitch outside. Comes from an athletic family. His dad, Tony, was the U.S. men's national team goalie. Hit well to short, but right to Gonzalez. Across the diamond, and a nice start to his Gateman career for Bryson Schaefer. He goes 1-2-3 in the top of the sixth. Let's head to the bottom of the inning. Your score 7-2, Wareham on top. David Glancy will meet Tommy Molsky. Molsky back out for his second inning of work.
Glancy.
Molsky significantly lowered his season ERA. He came into this outing with an ERA of 63 after that one blow-up outing. So some scoreless frames for him could really help bring that thing down. Chatham as a team, a 5.42 team ERA. The Gateman at 5.65. Glancy sees another slider. Glancy's been on once, sacrificed home a run in the first. 0-2, swing and a miss, strike three. Three sliders, three strikes, and one strikeout to begin the bottom of the sixth.
Now batting.
Very dominant start to his day out of the bullpen.
Seven, Dorian Gonzalez.
Dorian started off slow, but has put the ball in play once and walked in his last at-bat, finally got on base. So he's now looking for that first hit of the day.
First pitch, high and out. Our umpires today, Mickey Garcia is behind the plate. Joe Labella is at first, and Ryan DeMary is at third. Joe Labella was the home plate umpire the other night in Falmouth. 1-0, fouled back to the screen.
Have we seen all three of these guys before?
Yep. Mm-hmm. Seen it multiple times.
We're over a quarter of the way through the season. You would think at that point it was bound to happen.
We have seen most of these umpires multiple times,
right?
Through. Did have a umpire debut yesterday, though, slider down. Not in the sense of it's his first
tape
game umpire. It's the first time we've seen him. Michael Sabowski at first base. We've seen Labella, Jeff Merzel a few times. 2-1 over the Wareham Middle School building. Dorian trying to fight in the 2-2 count. Pitch. Outside.
We can finally see the full Wareham W logo, or at least most of it, behind home plate. For whatever reason, it was covered for a while. The first bunch of home games of the season.
How about that? Molsky loses Dorian Gonzalez, a one-out walk here in the bottom of the sixth.
Now batting.
So Labella at first base. This is his third Gateman game he's umpired this year. Got the one behind the plate versus Falmouth the other night. Here's Garen Caulfield. Caulfield still without a hit, but he reached base safely in the first when he got hit. Garen is an old rising junior. Pick back to no avail. He's 22 and a half years old, and that's partly because he attended San Joaquin Delta College his first 2 years, but did not appear in a game for him. First pitch, misses low. He was part of that wave of guys that simply put graduated high school at the wrong time. With the pandemic coming, his first season was entirely cut in 2020, and then the 2021 season out in California didn't really happen for him either. So came to Arizona last year as a baby-faced 21-year-old. Fouled off at the plate.
It's a wonderful way to put it. I'm sure he'll appreciate you saying that.
When Garen actually, too, really was not supposed to be an Arizona Wildcat, in all sense of things. When the signing class was announced the year prior in November 2020, they usually do it a little above a year in advance.
he was not on the signing class, but Arizona needed a infielder, middle infielder, and so the Arizona pitching coach, Nate Yeske at the time, reached out to the junior college, said, hey, you got any guys for us? And Guerin was the guy they had for him. Gonzalez attracting a lot of attention over there. DH'd a lot for the Wildcats this year. Played second base as well. And now awaits the 1-1 from Molsky. High and tight. Wareham looking to snap a three-game losing streak tonight. They're winless in their last four games if you include the tie against the Brewster Whitecaps on Monday. 2-1, runner goes. Skied, right side. Ken will give it a look and watch it clank off the bleachers. How about that matchup on Monday? You had two teams that were playing pretty well at that point. The highly anticipated reunion with Ryan Smythe going back to Brewster. And those teams combined since that matchup are 0-6.
And they'll meet on Monday here.
Something's got to give. 2-2, golfed. Left field. Schubert gets all sorts of turned around. He looks up at the wall, and he can't make the grab. Gonzalez got a really late break off of first, so he'll settle into second. A weird play for Nolan Schubert at the wall. It'll be a very long single, a well-hit ball from Guerin Caulfield. How about this? A 349-foot single for Guerin.
It's got to be the longest single that anybody's going to hit in the Cape League this season, huh? Although maybe a YD, because it kind of plays that way, that you could hit a really long ball and, you know, just, you know, hit it square off the fence and it could be a single.
Yeah, 350, that's YD's dimension to center
right,
field. You
right.
hit a 350-foot pop-up here. It's hitting Jansen Reeder right in the glove. He doesn't even have to move, but at YD it might hit off the top of the fence. Here's Aussie, takes high and wide. It reminds me to an interview we did with Ryan Smythe before the season started, and we were asking him how many bombs he could hit if we gave him 10 outs in a home run derby. And the first question he asked in response was, well, are we hitting at YD? You see that feeling, you can kind of understand why he said that. 1-0. Big swing and a miss for Grant. A nice slider from Molsky, clocking in at 84. We are powered by TrackMan this year. Once we are on the road, which we're going to be on Sunday night, you can see the fancy metrics across the GameCast. Got three pitcher metrics, three hitter metrics for you. 1-1. Back our way.
I don't think there's any need for us to look forward to going back on the road. It did not go very well the last time. We've enjoyed the parks, but I'm perfectly fine doing four games here in the next 5 days.
Well, the Gatemen are fine doing that as well.
Yeah.
They're 3-2 at home, just 1-4-1 on the road. And the first road win of the year at Falmouth. 1-2, crushed to center field. Going back, Reeder, it's going to get over his head, and one hop off the wall. Hands up in the air for Jansen as that ball goes under the fence. So Caulfield was burning behind Gonzalez. Let's see where they place the runners here. Hussey's going to do his due diligence and just cross the plate. As look at the first base umpire, Joe Labella, go all the way to the center field wall. He wants to get a read on it. And he is going to confirm that that ball did go out of play. So Reeder did a good job there. He immediately put his hands up. And that's unfortunate for Guerin Caulfield because I believe he was going to score on the play if Reeder could pick that one up off the base of the fence.
Can you imagine them giving him a home run on that?
I've seen it happen before, not here in the Cape League, but
it'd be his second of the game.
So one run across, Grant Hussey, who hit a grand slam in the first inning, adds more to his day.
It's a double, right?
It is ruled a double.
Yeah.
For Hussey, that's his seventh RBI of the day.
Ground rule double.
Hernandez, first pitch, popped up at first base. Kent Justin Territory will make the grab for out number two.
Now, do you differentiate in your scorebook ground rule double versus regular double, or we're just double?
Got a little G in there, just small.
Gotcha.
I mean, I think now for official scoring, I'm not sure how much it matters, but I like to be a little specific.
Right.
Nonetheless, a first pitch out, a pop-up to the first baseman, Kent. Here's the bottom of the lineup represented by J.C. Cologne. The bottom of the lineup for the Gateman has been on fire the past few games. Whoever's been down there has been producing. Runners on second and third. Pitch, low. So one run across for the Gateman here in the bottom of the sixth inning. An RBI double for Grant Hussey. Home run in the first, RBI single in the fourth, RBI double in the sixth. Cologne sees it outside. JC came into this game the leading hitter on the game, and if you look at batting average and you take into account that he's only had seven at-bats, but he's three for his first seven, 429 clip. Single in the first. Single in the third. Popped up. This is going to be trouble. The pitcher, Molsky, makes a nice basket catch, calling off both his catcher and the first baseman, Kent. So a nice play as Hobson, Kent, and Molsky all converged on it. Molsky the one to take it, and that'll be it for the Gateman here in the inning. Let's keep moving here. The Gateman with a big lead. Here we go to the seventh. The Wareham Gateman putting on a big offensive showing tonight, up 8-2 on the Chatham Anglers. And the first batter of the inning is going to be a pinch hitter. Mark Schallenberger will be lifted for Lyle Miller Green.
Number 13, Lyle Miller Green.
It's been a good thing on the Gateman side that Lyle Miller Green has not been in the lineup tonight. He tormented Wareham last Friday. 2-for-4 at the plate. The Austin Peay Governor awaits the first pitch from Schaefer. And it's there for strike one. Schaefer going with the changeup. Schaefer, a crafty guy, mixes speeds well. Not going to blow you away with the fastball. Count now even at one ball and one strike. We talked about Miller Green as being a nomad of sorts. Four schools inside. George Mason, Chipola Junior College, Oklahoma State, Austin Peay. This is his third season in Chatham. The native of Siberia. 2-1. Check swing, doesn't matter, called a strike by Mickey Garcia. Thanks for joining us tonight alongside Aiden Blank, our producers Rachel Manning and Braden Schenk. Jack Hunter here with you on the Gateman Baseball Network. 2-2 bender, skips to the plate. Miller Green also got a pinch hit at bat on Wednesday. Went 0-for-1. Fielder's choice, that went 5-2. 3-2, swing and a miss. A beauty of a breaking ball from Bryson Schaefer. And Miller Green is the first victim here in the seventh. Four up, four down for the Coastal Carolina Chanticleer. And another pinch hitter here for Chatham. It'll be Hudson White. We've had three pinch hitters in the last two innings for Chatham, down 8-2, trying to get some new life in the game. And White's first pitch he sees is low. White making the transfer from Texas Tech to Arkansas this past year. Check swing. First base umpire Joe Labella. Wonder if he's caught his breath yet from running all the way down the center field last inning. He rings him up. 1-1 count. Beautiful changeup from Schaefer and flicks a swing. White hit 296 for the Red Raiders this past year. Sent 11 balls over the fence. Big 12 honorable mention this year. Almost hit him on the back foot. Schaefer is a junior college guy who just finished his first year in Conway. Check swing. Does LaBella ring him up again? No. Count runs full. And he's an ultimate JUCO bandit, too. Two different junior colleges. Freshman year at Polk State College, 2022. His sophomore year at South Florida State College. And he comes home with a 3-2. Low and out. And Hudson White, in his pinch hit at bat, coaxes the walk.
Now batting, the center fielder from Kansas, number 40, Jansen Reeder.
And we have another pinch hitter. This time it'll be Tate Ballestero. So how about this? Three straight pinch hitters for Tom Holliday's Chatham Anglers. Four out of the last five hitters have been lifted. My scorecard is getting battered and bruised here in the seventh.
Well, in a game like this, you kind of expect it, right? You know, it's 8-2. Yes, you're still trying to come back, but putting some new names in the lineup, maybe not the worst thing. Again, Chatham lost an off day. They really have not had an off day, or at least a scheduled off day, this season.
Pick back to first. White back in safely. Well, Chatham, because of the rain out yesterday.
Right.
They were supposed to play Harwich. They changed their probable. They were supposed to throw Hayden Dirk again tonight, just like he threw last Friday night. But Witt was the one that got the start. And Ballestero spits on the fastball down.
Yeah, the two off days that they've gotten this season have been because of weather.
Rained out on opening day versus the Cattleers.
And they're going to lose the next one because they were rained out last night against Harwich. So they're going to play that on Tuesday. So it's, you know, it's a gauntlet for this Anglers team. You know, to have to be 3-6-1 at this point with as many games as they played, maybe not the worst thing in the world.
Closer pick than expected at first. And the Anglers are going to continue fighting uphill.
I'll tell you, I mean, he has a wonderful pickoff move.
With two big dates coming up. Golf to center. Stevenson under it. Four out number two.
So tomorrow's Katuit. They're first in the West. They're right up there.
So Chatham already lost three guys to Team USA. And when the MLB draft comes around, Tom Holliday has said quite literally he does not want to see Lyle Miller Green in an Angler uniform after the MLB draft. Wants to see him get drafted. Now, quick pick this time for Schaefer, stepping off the back of the rubber with the back foot. He's staying very in tune to what Hudson White is doing at first. Finally, a scheduled hitter. Carson Benge at the plate from the two-hole. Looks at a breaking ball for strike one. Benge, I don't think you could have had a much better start to your Cape season than he's had. In his first two games, 6-for-7. At the plate, a triple and a few RBIs to go along with it. 3-for-3 in his first game, 3-for-4 in the second. Lefty standing in against the lefty. Hit to first. Hussey, backhand, will step on the bag and take it himself. So a nice inning. For Bryson Schaefer works around a one-out walk. Let's stretch it out, and when we come back in the bottom of the seventh, the Gateman will come up to the plate, up eight here from Spillane Field. Stretched out and ready to go, and once again another night, and Aiden did not win any of our raffles here at Spillane Field.
I'll win it one of these nights. I got to buy a ticket first.
Oh, you didn't see? Media interns actually get free entries into this thing.
Is that right?
No, I'm just kidding with you. Alongside Aiden Blank, our producers Rachel Manning and Braden Shank. Jack Hunter here with you. Got some defensive substitutions to address in just a second. Tommy Molsky still out on the mound. Top of the order due up for the Gateman. Stevenson cranks that one back. So Casarella still at third base. He pinched it in the inning prior. Hudson White is in the game at catcher. A one, breaking ball sent back. So it looks like Lyle Miller-Green has moved to center field and Tate Ballestero has moved to right. So in total, Miller-Green in center, White at the plate. We wait the 0-2 windup from Molsky. Check swing. No appeal. The ball went back to the screen. The third base umpire, Ryan DeMary, says he didn't go. To finishing off that thought, Casarillo at third and Ballestero in right. So Tom Holliday is emptying out the bench here. It's been a clean outing for the Gateman pitching staff as a whole to this point. 1-2, roped, back up the middle of base hit. Josh Stevenson now with 6 hits in his last 2 games. When you got the hot hand, you just got to keep rolling, and he has here a leadoff single in the bottom of the 7th.
Now batting, the left fielder from West Virginia, number 12, Landon Wallace.
Talked about the Gateman hitting under 200 in leadoff spots coming into tonight. And that has changed tonight. They've reached base to lead off an inning 4 times here this evening, including in the first 3 innings, in which they tacked on 6 runs. Looking for more here in the bottom of 7th, Landon Wallace. Looks like he was about to take the 9-iron to that baseball. Stewart on deck, Glancy in the hole. Wallace, the West Virginia Mountaineer, formerly playing at Nevada. Sees it outside. Want to give a shout out to Ryan Smythe's daughter, Eliana. It's her 5th birthday tonight, and she's spending it here at the ballpark.
Is there a better way to spend your birthday than at Spillane Field?
Especially seeing her dad coach the Gateman right now to an 8-2 lead.
Yeah, she's gotten a lot to see. Whole bunch of runs. A lot of them came early, but, I mean, Gateman offense is just clicking, and it's good to see. You know, they needed it. It's been really good to see.
She and all the other fans here tonight cheering for the home team would love to see the Gateman finish this one. Just outside, Molsky shaking the head. Wanted it. The Gateman late in games has struggled mightily over the last few games. And when the pitching staff has struggled, it's been in those situations. 2-2. Count full. Stevenson off first, said he wanted to steal some bags this summer. We'll see if he goes here. Stays put. Wallace gets rung up on a nice pitch on the outer half.
It's his 2nd strikeout tonight.
Now batting the right fielder from Missouri State.
Molsky is the 3rd pitcher appearing for Chatham tonight. Tanner Witt, the starter, got there an inning plus. Liam Paddock got through 3 innings, surrendered 1 earned run. Molsky out for his 3rd inning of work here through 2 1/3. And now Stevenson's picked off at first. Kent chasing him, slapping the tag on his backside. And Stevenson will be caught stealing.
Well, he almost made it. You got to give him credit there. He almost made it to 2nd base, but couldn't quite get in there.
A good heads-up play by Molsky, picking off the runner. Infield now making a big shift over. Miola on the other side of the bag. Popped up. Left field. Schubert there, and he'll grab it for the 3rd out of the inning. So Stevenson singles, but gets caught stealing. So Molsky faces the minimum here in the 7th. Let's move to the 8th. It's Wareham 8 and Chatham 2 on the Gateman Baseball Network. Bryson Schaefer's day is done after two innings, and a good outing it was for the Chanticleer. Two innings, zero hits, zero runs, one walk, and one strikeout. And for a Gateman pitching staff that has struggled so mightily with walks and free passes in general, they're last in the league in that category. Witrowski hit one batter, did not walk a guy. Schaefer walked one guy. So when you combine those two together, only two free passes tonight, along with zero errors committed by the Gateman defensively. They've really flipped the page, washed last night's loss, but they got to finish strong here. Koger on the mound, the third pitcher for the Gateman.
Now batting.
He was the one who started last Friday versus the Chatham Anglers. It was an up and down start for Koger.
Yeah, and you've seen they go to Koger, who is not usually a guy to come in this situation, and they do that because the last couple of games, finishing has been the problem, especially yesterday. So you don't want to let your foot off the gas quite yet.
You can't let your foot off the gas when you got 3, 4, and 5 due up for the Anglers. It's Nolan Schubert, Chris Maldonado, and Caden Kent. Schubert a double in the first. I think my ears are still ringing from it. A mile high pop-up. This one is going to bang off the asphalt. A little kid playing catch down there is going to go grab it in the alley. Right place, right time for the young man.
But since that double, they've struck him out twice. They've been able to really get him. But the problem is now he's due.
1-1. On the corner. So Koger in his last start on Friday took a no decision. 4 innings, 4 hits, 3 earned runs, 1 walk, and 3 strikeouts. He was one of 4 pitchers on the day for the Gateman. All 4 pitchers labored through their innings. Neither Bowery, Yetter, Hughes, or Koger blew up. And Schubert's going to take time, remove the glasses, and get something out of his eye. But when you combine the 4 pitcher performances together, it didn't add up
right
to a great performance. Chatham winning that game 7-4. 1-2 from Koger. Swing and a miss, strike 3. Hernandez able to keep it in the circle. Fires to first. 4 out, number 1.
Now batting, the second baseman from Vanderbilt, number Koger 2, Chris Maldonado.
Also pitched in the third game of the season, a relief outing versus Kituit. So this is his second outing out of the pen. Now steps Vandy's Chris Maldonado. Righty on righty action. And the first pitch, curveball that bleeds down and out. If the Maldonado name sounds familiar at Vanderbilt, well, his older brother Nick is the closer for the Commodores. The top reliever for Vandy. Fouled off at the plate. This one got a piece of Maldonado. Maldonado here at the Cape to do what anybody does, try to get better, try to put on a show, but also to try to play more in the field. Made 39 starts at the DH role for Tim Corbin's Commodores. Tim Corbin said he can play just about anywhere, but they wouldn't know because they DH him all year. So the home plate umpire, Mickey Garcia, is going to step in the way, tell Koger to slow things down as Maldonado is still trying to shake it off. Slide stepping to the plate, inside. Koger, one of 2 Gatemen to return to the team this year. It's him and Ryan Campos, who has the off night tonight. Two-one. Brushes Maldonado off the plate. Pitched the third most innings for Wareham last summer, just over 25. At a 4-2-1 ERA. 3-1. Step on back. Here's Maldonado.
Couple of those tonight.
Maldonado trying to reset here. Full count, one out in the inning. 8-2 Wareham. To short. It eats Gonzalez up, and he tries to recover, but it's too late. So still
the first baseman from Texas
being decided on is the official score. Caden Kent will come to the plate, but regardless, Maldonado is on first. Gonzalez charged that ball hard and ate him up. So it's going in the books officially now as a hit, but subject to review. First pitch to Kent misses outside. Kent, another guy with much to gain being here this summer. A talented bat, obviously comes from a great baseball family, son of Jeff Kent, but did not play a whole lot this year for A&M. Getting a lot of those SEC programs, playing time is at a premium. Koger, fastball, slider, curveball, and changeup. Those are the tools he's working with. And the 1-1 changeup misses outside. Talking to Will before his start last Friday, he said that he's here really trying to throw his breaking balls for strikes, especially the curveball early in the count. 2-1 on the corner, count even at 2 balls and 2 strikes. Just completed his second year pitching for the Louisville Cardinals, and it was a much improved year from his freshman year. Dropped his ERA from 12.27 to 4.81. He's got Kent in a 2-strike count. Long set, pitch, swing and a miss, strike 3. 2 punch outs in the inning for Koger. And Xavier Casarillo, who pinch hit for Donahue in the sixth, comes back for the second time tonight. Wareham looking to put a halt to a 3-game losing streak. You got to try to avoid those losing streaks here in Cape Cod. First pitch fouled back because wins are so hard to come by. You can't necessarily just get yourself in a hole and rely on your team to be able to play insane baseball or go on a huge winning streak. The way this league goes, it's very difficult to come by a long winning streak, which is why Katuit's 8-3 start is crazy impressive. Lancey, Gonzalez, and Caulfield do up in the Gateman bottom half of the eighth. Koger, the third pitcher to work here tonight for Wareham. Takes a deep breath, and the pitch gets through Hernandez's 5-hole. A wild pitch will move Maldonado up to second. The Gateman wasted no time after Chatham scored a run in the top of the first. Wareham responded with a 5-run bottom of the first. Grant Hussey hit a ball over the right field fence, a grand slam, his first in a Gateman uniform to break things open. Chopped perfectly down the third base line. Cologne slings it back, and it's going to go over Gonzalez's head. Maldonado's going to come around and score. And Ryan Smythe is going to come out. He thinks that ball hit Casarillo in the box. Didn't hear anything, but it looked like it might have hit him because the ball took a ton of spin.
Yep.
You usually don't see, you just hit it off the bat and the ball land perfectly down the third base line like that.
Exactly.
It looked like it almost redirected. So now the umpires will convene here with 2 outs. So you're writing with pen in your scorebook. Maybe hold off here until they're done.
Yeah, that would be me.
That makes two of us, partner.
Penn's the only way to do it.
So we've got Mickey Garcia, Ryan DeMary, and Joe LaBella meeting just in front of the mound and to the third base side of it. And the Gateman dugout and Ryan Smythe are very unhappy with the call. And you could sense the pressure here because no lead is safe for Wareham with what has happened the last two nights. So when all is said and done, an infield single for Casarillo, a throwing error by Cologne will advance Maldonado home. First pitch now to Miola is inside.
Needing out here. Got to get out of this thing. You're up by five. Don't want to push it.
Miola still new to the Anglers. Did not play the last time these two teams faced. This is his fifth game he's played for Chatham. Did not play 2 days ago versus Harwich. Outside. But the infielder expected to get some more looks now because you take an All-American bat out of your lineup in J.J. Weatherholt. You got to find some guys to replace it. 2-0. To short, Gonzalez takes it. The short route to second. The fielder's choice will end things in the top of the eighth. But Chatham gets one run across on a weird play. They leave one stranded. Wareham commits one error. And we go to the bottom of the eighth. It's now 8-3 Wareham on top here on the Gateman Baseball Network. Tommy Molsky back out for his fourth inning of work. And we've received great news here in the press box. Our little production assistant, Sebastian Spinelli, 2-0 this weekend
in
the baseball
tournament.
Yeah, how
about that? Go Sebastian. Number 11,
David Glenn. Great start to the weekend. Sebastian, the son of our boss, Jay Spinelli, head of our media team here for the Wareham Gateman. Clancy gets brushed off the plate inside. Clancy, Gonzalez, Caulfield. Due up here in the bottom of the eighth. Molsky just misses one of that one. This has been a fantastic outing for Molsky. Not done yet, but after his blow-up versus the Kootuat Cattleers in which he gave up 7 earned runs in one inning, the fact that we're here, 3+ innings of work, only 1 earned run allowed. It's a bright spot today for the Anglers in what's been a dark game for them. But Glancy has now worked a 3-0 count.
We mentioned tomorrow, 6 p.m., against Kootuat projected starters, Aiden Major. We've seen him a little bit, one appearance so far. But this will be his first Gateman start.
Now a 3-1 count.
And he will be opposed by Cole Mathis, who has thrown 2 games so far, and also hit, plays both ways.
Working from the windup, Molsky has the sign, 3-1. Breaking ball outside, and David Glancy now on base for the second time tonight. David still with the league lead in home runs with 3.
Miami, number 7, Dorian Gonzalez.
Here's Dorian Gonzalez.
Gonzalez knows a thing or two about walking. He's done it twice.
White, the catcher set up outside. First pitch fouled off, and I missed during Glancy's at-bat a cool tape connection. Tate Ballestero, the right fielder, member of the St. John's Red Storm baseball team. So David Glancy, I guess now considered a former teammate of his, leading off first. The Big East represented up here in the Northeast. Glancy tries the vault steal, gets picked off, and is gunned at second.
Close, though. A lot closer than a lot of guys could have made it in that situation.
So in kind of a new age of base running where these guys like to kind of hop into their steal, but it sets you up to be picked off if the pitcher sees it. And Molsky did there. Glancy picked off since he was tagged at second, and it'll go down as a caught stealing since he was going forward. Back to the plate, 0-1 count. Pitch to Gonzalez. high and wide.
Well, the next couple of days for the Gateman pitching-wise should be locked down. Aiden Major tomorrow. We're all very curious in his Gateman debut. You got Mark Manfredi on Sunday at Hyannis, and then we know that Coleman Picard goes Monday against Brewster. So three very winnable games. Anytime any one of those three guys is on the mound, you got to win the game because they're so good, they can get you a win.
1-2, back our way. You got to take advantage of the Manfredi and Picard starts while you can with the MLB draft coming up. The Gateman roster shouldn't change all too much, but from the starting pitching perspective, both of those guys are candidates to be drafted. Both of them draft eligible. 1-2, same spot.
And you would expect at least one of those two spots to get filled because they're both starters that go long. You would expect Ryan Smyth to maybe make a call to somebody and pick up at least one new guy to come in and make some starts. Maybe two.
Picard and Witrowski, Bryant Bulldog teammates, have the two longest starts of the year for the Gateman at five apiece. 1-2, foul tipped. And Gonzalez goes down on strikes.
Like I said, Dorian had a good night. If that's his last at bat, two walks. And both times he got on, he scored.
Baseman from Arizona, number 20, Garrett
it is pretty
Alfield.
Special for these Bryant Bulldogs to be playing here for the Wareham Gateman because Bryant in Rhode Island is going to be closest here to Wareham.
Right.
So to have two guys from that America East program playing not too far from Smithfield, Rhode Island, and succeeding has been probably pretty cool for that coaching staff. 0-1 count to Garen Caulfield. Caulfield singled, was stranded on third in the sixth. The Arizona Wildcat spits on the breaking ball. Olski having a little bit of a tough time handling the ball out there on the mound. Garen had a great freshman year for Arizona. Dipped a little bit in productivity this season. 1-1. Hard hit, backhanded snag. A nice play by Miola and a nice pick at first from Kent. So the Gateman get retired here in the bottom of the eighth. Let's go to the ninth now, holding a 5-run lead, trying to close out the Chatham Anglers here for the fourth home win of the year. The Gateman tonight trying to avoid the ninth inning scaries after blowing a big lead last night in Yarmouth, in which they gave up four runs in the bottom of the ninth on just one hit, committing two errors. The page is turned to tonight. A 5-run advantage heading into the top of the inning with Lyle Miller-Green greeting the new Gateman, Yoel Tejeda. The first pitch chopped back up over the mound. Caulfield gets the big hop to first. One pitch, one out for the newly minted Florida State Seminole.
Yeah, Yoel recently transferred. He spent his spring appearing in a few games with the Florida Gators. Not the most successful spring, but again, he was used to dominating. You look at his high school numbers, he was kicking butt. And he comes to Florida and, you know, as expected, maybe gets rocked out a little bit. But now he's going to go to Florida State, a new start for him and a chance to really cement himself. He's a starter, or at least capable of starting, so maybe that's the role he plans on getting into, but not now.
First pitch slider across to Hudson White. White's in his second plate appearance after pinch hitting for Caden Hobson, the starting catcher. And the ninth spot in the order, Tate Ballestero due up to follow. Screamer, first base side, snagged by Hussey for out number two.
We nicknamed him Yoel, what is it, Yoel Tani?
Oh, there we go, yeah.
Because he has hit. He did not really hit for Florida, but he's capable of it. And I'm sure Ryan Smyth knows that. He's capable of playing first base, and, you know, maybe you give Hussey a day off or sub him out late in a game and let Yoel come in there.
Ballestero to hit. So Tejeda got two outs on three pitches, and he's a switch hitter. In high school, his senior year, hit .355, four home runs, one triple, 30 RBIs. Misses down. And on the mound as well, just a casual 15-0 season with a 1-4 ERA.
Yeah.
2-0. Now three balls and zero strikes. That 15-0 note, I want to correct myself, for his career, went 8-0. That's still pretty solid with a 1.82 ERA his senior year.
Yeah, 15 starts in a high school season would be pretty impressive.
Midweek starter for the Gators this year. Flips a strike on the low part of the zone. Ballestero looking to keep things alive for Chatham in the top of the ninth. Off of Hernandez's mask. Home plate umpire Garcia going to come out in front of the mound to give Yachty some time.
Katuit, YD, Bourne, all winners tonight. Harwich up 2-1 on Orleans. This is the only other game going on besides that. Both in the ninth.
Get this. Gateman offense tonight, the eighth inning was the first time they didn't have a hit.
There you go.
Consistent pressure. 3-2, slider down and in. And Ballestero extends this game for one more batter, at least.
Now batting.
So Bourne will get 2 points.
From Oklahoma State.
They're still
number
in
seven,
back of
Carson Bench.
The Gatemen. But they could jump Falmouth with this win tonight. They actually will.
Carson Bench, the lefty, to meet Tejeda. That one almost kills our crowd mic.
It survived.
That thing's got more life than a cat. It's been battered and bruised the first 11 games of the year. 0-1. Down, count even.
Katuit is now, what, 9-3?
With
the
win tonight, yep.
Wow. That's 18 points.
Talk about having a hit. They're having a win pretty much on a nightly basis. Back to the screen again.
Well, Hyannis didn't win tonight, so Wareham will jump them in the standings should they win this. They would go to 5-4-1. No, 5-5-1.
Wareham would
5-6-1.
Would be 1 point still behind the Harbor Hawks, but a chance to
right.
get them on Sunday.
Yep.
1-2 now. Over Gonzalez's head at short and into center field. Well struck by Ballestero coming off the track man at 97 miles an hour off the bat.
Boy, did he barrel that up. And now Schubert, who had that double and has since done very little.
Number 49, Sam Antonucci.
Ah, they're going to
Heartland Community College.
Sub him out. This is Sam Antonucci. So Tom Holliday trying to keep this rally going. And Ryan Smythe holding his breath.
First pitch is there, and, you know, interesting to take Schubert out of the game, too. Schubert, arguably the best hitter on this Anglers team, and with one swing, couldn't tie the game, but at least make it an interesting situation for the Gatemen. Tejeda's 0-1. The Gatemen are now one strike away. So Antonucci, another Chuco guy.
Quick sub over at first base. Should get 59. That's Brian Holliday.
Runner for the Anglers, number 59, Brian Holliday.
Starting pitcher. College of Central Florida product. Getting his legs loose. Getting some of that lactic acid out of that right arm.
But no relation to Tom that we know of.
Antonucci at the plate. Going to be a Chanticleer next year. Going to be a teammate with Bryson Schaefer, who was fantastic for the Gateman today on the mound. 2-2 count now. Coastal Carolina sent eight guys here to the Cape this summer. Very impressive. Hosted a regional this year. Antonucci going to join. He awaits the 2-2 pitch from Tejeda. Ground ball up the middle. It's got eyes. It gets into center. Coming around and scoring is Ballestero. Moving to third now is Bench. And the Anglers aren't dead yet. It's now 8-4 here in the top of the ninth.
Well, credit to, was that Reeder who scored the run there?
Ballestero.
Yeah, credit to him because he he saw the opportunity there. Or rather, Bench, and who was subbed out by Holliday. Credit to Holliday, who saw the opportunity to take another base. And, you know, you're down four runs in the ninth inning, not much of a risk.
First pitch. Home plate umpire Garcia thought about just ringing up Maldonado in the swing, but chooses to call it a strike. Tejeda, one run conceded here in the ninth. Looking to stop it at that.
Gaiman still looking for that closer. You know, they had maybe, you know, they got a couple of good outings out of Yetter. They haven't really had a, you know, dominant closer this season.
1-1 to short. Gonzalez on the backhand, short route to second. And the Wareham Gateman reel in the Anglers tonight. Your final score, Gateman 8, Chatham 4. A well-needed victory for the Gateman to get back in the win column after three straight losses. Their first win since Sunday night here. And Wareham improves to 4-2 here at the friendly confines of Spillane Field.
And 5-6 overall, they're right around 500. You stay there, you're probably going to be at least in the mix for the playoffs. So they're battling, and I think that they really came alive tonight. It was a great start. Five runs in the first inning is, you know, exactly what they needed, and now they have a chance to continue that in the West Division tomorrow. A win over Catoosa would be huge. You know, someone's got to try and make up some ground on them. They're not slowing down, so winning against them tomorrow would be big, and then we'll go Sunday, in the conclusion of this West Division swing against Hyannis.
All smiles and the handshake lines for the Gateman. For the Anglers in the ninth, one run on two hits, zero errors, and two left. So a little bit of a scare in the ninth, but Tejeda able to close it in a non-save situation. Once again, all smiles tonight here from the ballpark. Your final score, Wareham 8, Chatham 4. A big five-run first inning propels it to a victory. Brett Witrowski is going to get the win. This is the first win by a Gateman starter this year. And Tanner Witt will pick up the loss in his Anglers debut. Once again, the final score here tonight, 8-4. Join us for our next broadcast tomorrow night as the Catoosa Cattaliers head to Spillane Field. Airtime is at 5:45 for the 6 p.m. first pitch. The Gateman Baseball Network is a production of both Wareham Community Television and the Wareham Gateman. On behalf of our producers, Rachel Manning and Braden Schenck, our director of broadcasting, Jay Spinelli, and our production assistant, Sebastian Spinelli. The president of the Gateman is Glenn Hannington. And it's been a fun night here tonight at the ballpark. Once again, alongside Aiden Blank, Jack Hunter here with you, signing off. A big win tonight for the boys. Back tomorrow. We'll talk to you then.